So Shackleton realized that the only way that they would get help would be to make a journey away from Elephant Island. And even though it was his cardinal rule to try and keep the whole party together, he determined that they would have to make a voyage and seek help elsewhere. So the closest piece of land to where they were at Elephant Island, this is ironic, you know, I bought the giant, giant map, but the part that I need to talk about is up here. The closest piece of land to where they were at Elephant Island was Tierra del Fuego, that southern tip of South America. But because of the prevailing westerly winds across the Drake Passage and the Southern Ocean here, there was no way that they could sail against those winds and make it to Tierra del Fuego. The only thing that they could do would be to go east with the westerlies and try to make it back to South Georgia Island, that island where the five Norwegian whaling stations were. Shackleton proposed a journey of 800 miles across the stormiest and most violent and most treacherous ocean in the world. At these latitudes here, you can see it kind of on the small inset map, except for the Palmer Peninsula kind of sticking out there, there's a whole ring of latitudes around the globe here where there's just no land whatsoever. And so the winds encircle the globe there in those latitudes, and they whip around the globe unbridled and unchecked, unimpeded, and they push along before them a series of waves so huge and so treacherous that the whalermen of the Southern Ocean have a special name for them. They call them the Cape Horn Rollers or the Graybeards. And these are waves a half mile between crests. These are waves that are 30 and 40 feet tall, wave after wave after wave. Just to give you some point of reference, the highest point of the ceiling in this room here is probably between 20 and 25 feet. And we're talking about waves that are 30 and 40 feet tall, wave after wave after wave. Shackleton decided that he would take five men with him. They would be a party of six. And he chose to go with him Frank Worsley, the captain of the Endurance. Worsley's great skill as a navigator and a handler of small boats had become strikingly evident during the seven-day boat journey to Elephant Island. Shackleton knew that he would have need of Worsley's navigational skill. He chose Tom Crean to come with him. Shackleton knew that he would have need of Crean's great strength and great endurance. And he chose to take with him Harry McNeish, the carpenter, and two of the able seamen, Jack Vincent and Tim McCarthy. McNeish went to work. Frank Wild begged to come along on this journey, but Shackleton knew that there was nobody else that he could trust to remain behind and look after the welfare of those 22 men that would be left behind on Elephant Island and keep their morale up while they awaited rescue. McNeish went to work right away on the James Caird, the strongest and best of the three boats that they had, trying to make her seaworthy for this perilous, perilous journey. They took the mast of the second boat, the Dudley Docker, and they lashed it to the keel of the Caird to stiffen her keel so that she wouldn't break her back in the heavy seas of the Southern Ocean. And then McNeish scavenged a few boards from the other boats, and he raised her sides, he raised her gunwales to give her a little more depth, a little bit more freeboard. And even though there wasn't enough lumber for him to be able to make any kind of a solid decking over the Caird, he scavenged a piece of a packing crate here and a ski there and a sledge runner there, and he built kind of a framework of a decking over the Caird, and then they covered that with canvas. They had a supply of sailcloth with them. It was frozen hard as a board, but they thawed it foot by foot over the blubber stove until it was pliable enough to work with. And then the men, with their terribly painful, frostbitten hands, they sewed and sewed and sewed that canvas into shape, and they made a covering, and they tacked that over that framework, leaving a little cockpit opening that was 2 feet wide and 4 feet long back by the rear thwart where the helmsman would sit and steer the boat. and they made kind of a little cabin. They closed her off and made a place where the men could go below and get some sleep without every wave of the Southern Ocean sloshing over them. They took with them 6 weeks' supply of food, two small Prima stoves and two small cooking pots, two casks of fresh water, which Charlie Green had laboriously thawed from freshwater ice over the blubber stove there on the shore of Elephant Island. And they had a sextant and a couple of navigational charts and books and a pair of binoculars and a compass. And that was about it. On the morning of April 24th, the sun came out briefly. And Worsley took his sextant and he snapped a sight. And because he knew their coordinates there at Elephant Island, he was able to do a reverse calculation and check the accuracy of his chronometer. They had started out on the Endurance with 40 or 50 working chronometers, but at this point there was only one left, and that was Worsley's own personal chronometer that he wore on a cord around his neck where he could keep it warm and safe and somewhat protected against his chest. He did the calculation. It turned out that his chronometer was indeed accurate. They ballasted the cairn with 2.25 tons of rocks that they collected there on the beach at Elephant Island. And at 12:30 on April 24th, 1916, the six men of the cairn took their leave and started out on their hazardous journey, leaving the other 22 men standing there on the beach, waving bravely as their best and last and only hope vanished over the horizon. As soon as they got out beyond the shelter of the island, as soon as they got out into the Southern Ocean, they began to experience those huge waves, those Cape Horn rollers, those graybeards. And those waves were such that every 90 seconds, the sails of the cairn would suddenly go slack as a huge wall of water rose up behind them and blocked those winds that blew from astern. And then the cairn would rise, climbing the face of that wave. She would rise to a dizzying height, and then she would be caught in the foam and the spray at the top, and she would seem to shoot forward into nothingness, just thin air, and then she would sink, sickeningly into the trough. And this was repeated every 90 seconds, every minute and a half, for the next 17 days as the cairn journeyed across 800 miles of the most perilous ocean in the world.